Props. Wow. Ooh. Are you wired for sound? Do you need a... You need a headset? Oh, get another mic. Right, can we just pray for Maxine before we get on? Lord, thank you for Maxine. Thank you for everything that she's been able to prepare for us tonight. I pray that the message she has for us we'll take to heart and we'll learn more about you and about your love for us. Amen. And we'll find out what the foam swords are for.
Ooh.
Just the right height.
I don't know what that sound effect was. Sorry. That's why I chose it. Oh, I made things move on a... I don't know if you want to sing that song, but you are now. Right, actually, this is a bad thing. We're going to play a game. Right, so first of all, I'm not Izzy and I'm not John. Hard to tell the difference, I know. Yeah, Izzy's poorly. She was going, and then sort of late this afternoon, she said she couldn't do tonight. And she's done some brilliant work on her epilogue, and we really want her to be able to share it with you. So I haven't kind of stolen her thunder by doing the theme we were supposed to be doing tonight. So instead, we're going to do something a bit Christmassy. So I need two volunteers. Let's have Ethan and, is that you, Becky, under there? No, Sophia. Yes, let's do it for the girls. Come on. Right. You need to put a blindfold, that's what it's called, on. Oh, right, before you put the blindfold on, could you just, right, Ethan, if you could stand there. And Sophia, if you could stand over here. Right. Yes, now you can put your blindfolds on. Evelyn's threatening Sophia. Okay, Ethan, here you are. Lovely. Sophia, here you are. I'm not sure if you're close enough together, but... Right, what's going to happen is this. Okay, blindfolded, no cheating. I don't know why I looked at you, Ethan, sorry. I'm sure you'll be perfectly fair. Sorry. What? No, nothing. So, can you breathe, Sophia? I'm actually quite concerned. Okay, you can take your mask off, I think. This is an active game, is it not? Is that allowed? Yeah. Yeah, please don't suffocate whilst playing my game. Okay, what we need to do is you're going to have 60 seconds, which Danny Fleming is going to time. And then, Chris Stanford, if you could keep count for Sophia, and Lucy Earle, could you keep count for Ethan? So you've got 60 seconds. Now, the first thing I'm going to say is this. Play nicely. Okay? You're going to have a sword fight. Well, actually, a lightsaber fight, hence the colours. Reference, I know. And you're going to have a lightsaber fight. And the person who lands the most body blows, not head, no heads. I know you can't see, so I don't know why. Anyway, the person who lands the most body touches it with your lightsaber in 60 seconds is the winner. However, there is a plank on the floor. I know you can't see that either. Ha ha ha. And if you fall out of the plank, you immediately lose the game. So. Yeah. Alrighty. So, Daniel Fleming, are you? I have no idea if this is going to work. This is hastily put together at best. Sorry? Oh, yeah. That's true. Okay, Daniel Fleming, When they're ready. There. There you are. Very good. Danny, are you going to do the countdown?
I'll do the countdown. Okay. Go on, then. 3, 2, 1, go.
Ethan! Gentle, gentle. Oh, are we counting? Okay, stand a bit further apart. Come on, Sophia, come on! Lower, lower, lower! Ah! Ethan wins. Okay, I think Sophia has been disarmed. I think she has lost. But how? What was the body count? Are you all right, Sophia? Good. What was the count?
35,
roughly. What was the other one? 37. Oh, Ethan's one or two counts. Okay, now, I think Joe and Adam, you're next. Could you come and take your place? You both volunteered, didn't you? You put your hand. Okay, here, have a clean blindfold. Clean blindfold. COVID. COVID. Clean blindfold. Clean, clean, clean. Clean blindfold. Thank you all. Thank you. Okay. Now, wait a minute. No, that's not fair. Okay. All right then. Three, 2, 1, go. Gentle! Mind the people at the front. And the microphones. Danny.
30 seconds.
What? No way. Let's stop after 40. Oh, 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 Joe's been Okay, stop now. Okay. Right. I believe that Adam may have won that. I don't know what gave it away. And sorry, Joe, we actually did stack the odds there. What happened halfway through that was Joe was sort of flailing up here and you were just taking his legs out, basically. And then Chris joined in with yeah. There must be video footage. Well done. Very good game. Good game. Good game. Right. Now, the point of that is there is no point of that. It's just because. So this is my tenuous link. So it's Christmas. At Christmas, we watch films. One of the least Christmassy films, just like your film, not Christmassy, is Star Wars. Ooh. Right. Because there is a very vague tenuous link to Star Wars. Battering each other, and particularly the theme of hope. I know, it's tenuous, but I had like an hour to come up with something. So, you know, this is as good as it gets under pressure. And I believe that, because I'm not a Star Wars expert, it has to be said, I believe that the very first Star Wars film was called A New Hope, was it not?
Yeah.
Yes. See, I do know some stuff. Okay, we're not getting into that discussion. And basically, it takes the setting of it. It takes place when Anakin Skywalker has been, he's fallen, hasn't he? And Darth Vader and the Empire is on the rise. Is that not true? And so we have like, yeah, and you know the rest. So you follow these two, a young boy and a young girl, and I'm not gonna spoil it, obviously. We've all watched it, apart from me. And one of the most famous lines in the movie, and I know this because we have a toy at home with lots of lines from Star Wars. One of the lines is, "Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi, you're my only hope." Is that not right? And I know that Obi-Wan Kenobi is Ewan McGregor, because that is, except it was Alec Guinness in the first one. But, because, you know, anything with Ewan McGregor is worth watching, frankly. Anyway, so Leia, Princess Leia, is under the impression that he is their only hope. Now, basically, everything is all about death and destruction, and the Empire's reach knows no limitations, and everything looks hopeless. The universe is in turmoil and disarray. Now, one of my all-time favourite films, actually my favourite book, is this one. Can we have the clip? Maybe. Thank you. Any excuse to play a clip from this, basically. Oh. Not the, oh. I'll play it on my phone and you can all crowd rap. No, you can't. COVID. Oh. Oh no, did I send a bad link? It's probably my fault. Oh no, there we are. I know! It's my fave. If you were in a cinema with me right now, I'd be going, shh. Oh. I know, we could watch it all, but there's too much. Fun fact. Whoops. When they made that film, that I didn't want to see it actually. I love that story so much. You know when they go and wreck your favourite book? So I didn't want to see it, but I did see it. And I don't tend to cry in films, but I absolutely bored in that one. Because when she went through that wardrobe, it was just like, in my head, what I imagined it was like. And I was so relieved, I think, more than anything. And now I watch it and I think, oh my goodness, she's got a cute little nose and munchy cheeks like Bethan. Anyway, I know. There we are. So that's one of my all-time favourite films. And one of the themes in The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, just like Star Wars, is hope. Because before Lucy, Edmund, Peter and Susan arrive in Narnia, the concept of hope was not really something that existed amongst the people in that magical land. The White Witch had kept that world in an eternal winter without the arrival of Christmas. And characters like Mr. Tumnus and the Beavers, Mr. and Mrs. Beaver, live without hope that there'll be any warmth and that the tyranny of the White Witch will ever end. And it's only with the children's arrival through the wardrobe that they remember the prophecy and suddenly a chance of defeating the White Witch becomes a possibility. Their hope comes to life, that they would one day see Christmas and a happier land. And the story shows how hope has such a powerful feeling on the people, because when the children arrive and they become united in their hope, then you see Narnia begin, the snow begin to melt and the White Witch's power starts to weaken and Christmas Day arrives. And so this internal enchanted winter on Narnia, which symbolises kind of a dead, stagnant time where there's no life, where nothing grows, suddenly that starts to be reversed. I don't know, I loved the snow day on Monday. I know most of you did not have a snow day, but we did. But it doesn't take long for us all to get sick of the cold, does it? And so if you can imagine an eternal winter, that's what it was like in Narnia. Now, we are entering a time of year where we can be expectant and hopeful. Unfortunately, if you turn on the news and you see how much mess our world is in, how much terrorism and murder and lying and cheating there is, and not just in the world around us, but in us too. None of us are perfect. We're all in our own ways in a muddle and a mess. We all have our own weaknesses and struggles with sin. And that's just a few ways that sin shows its ugly head in our world. Sin is the underlying problem all of humanity faces, and that's what brings the chaos to the world around us. And so when we watch the news, it's easy to feel really hopeless. And when we see the crazy things that happen, maybe even in our own schools, it can seem pretty hopeless too. But there is a huge problem with this idea, because the Bible tells us something very differently. The Bible tells us that we should have hope. The Bible tells us we have real reason for hope. So, Psalm 25, verse 5. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you, O our God, my Saviour, and my hope is in you all day long. Psalm 42, verse 5. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Saviour and my God. Psalm 62, verse 5, yes, my soul, find rest in God. My hope comes from him. And I was sharing at student group on Tuesday that our family verse is Romans 5, 1-5, where it tells us to rejoice in your sufferings, for sufferings produce perseverance, perseverance character, character hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured it into us by his Holy Spirit. God brings us real hope. Hope we can count on. In fact, Jesus came to earth to bring us hope. He saw that the world was a mess and it was chaos and we were separated from God because of our sin, and he wanted to change that. Our hope, your hope, the world's hope for a better life is in Jesus. And so just like when the children landed in Narnia, hope came to life. For us, when we think about Christmas, when Jesus landed in that manger in the stable at what we call Christmas, hope became a reality. And so when you, I don't know, have you got an advent calendar? When you count down your advent calendars, when you look at the lights on the tree, when you have all of this stuff going on about Christmas, I want you to really know that this is not just about a happy thing. It's a moment that brought real hope and changed the course of absolutely everything. Another of my favourite passages in the Bible is from the beginning of John, and it says this: in the beginning was the Word. The Word's another name for Jesus. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In the Message version, it says, the Word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. So, as we're looking towards Christmas, I want you to begin to challenge yourself that we have real reason for hope, and ask God to show you that and to put that reality in your heart. And also that his coming meant that he moved into our neighborhood, that he's with us, that he is present, and that presence makes all the difference, bringing light and hope and life, just like Narnia when the children arrived and hope and life began to emerge. Shall we pray? Father, I want to thank you for your hope. Thank you that you don't abandon us, you don't leave us to our own devices, but you're there present with us. You came into our dirty, broken, disarray, chaotic world, dark world, and you brought light and hope and life and grace and mercy and forgiveness and kindness. And Lord, in our world now, with so much to worry about, so much that doesn't make sense, I pray that this Christmas for us, your light and hope will make all the difference. In our hearts, I pray you will come, and I pray that your presence will transform us and our perspective. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We can have another song. Come on then. Is it? Ooh, that was because we fought for so long. Sorry.